so it's great to be here. And so please, so the format of the lecture, so they asked me to put some notes together. I did this yesterday, as you see, that the notes are not very professional. But I would like you to, I would very much urge you to interrupt me at any time when you don't understand anything. And don't be afraid to ask stupid questions, because that's the only way you can learn things. So today I would like to talk a little bit about the more general framework in which you can formulate DMRG and these kind of matrix product state algorithms and extensions out of it, and show that actually there's many different things in statistical physics, and especially in statistical physics actually, that that connect to this framework of matrix product states. And one of the central one of the central things there is the concept of a matrix product operator, and that will be the emphasis of the lecture today. So what I know. So depending on the feedback that I get from the audience, I planned to also include some more advanced kind of sections into the lecture today, like how can you understand the beta ansatz, or the algebraic beta ansatz, this quantum inverse scattering method within this formalism. But if I feel that the time is not right for this, and I can skip this to tomorrow or the day after. But nevertheless, I think it's good to know that all these kind of things are also beta ansatz kind of fits within this framework. And that's all very, very much related to it. And it's not just, so DMRG is not just one method that magically works. No, it's really interconnected to many different methods, and there's very close links to it. And one of the easiest ways to understand all these links and the reason also why this method works very well is to formulate it in terms of these matrix product operators. So on the paper, there's some references where you can find most of the things that I will talk to about. But anyway, so just before, because I still just wanted to motivate at least a little bit, why do I want to talk about matrix product states, or what is the main reason why I am excited about matrix product states? It's because if you look back at the history of quantum mechanics, actually many of the really big breakthroughs have been obtained by actually, if you look back at the history of quantum mechanics, it's all about trying to find approximate solutions of the many body string regulation. Okay, of course you have high energy physics and all, but let's talk about like the more relativistic physics. It's just you have the many body string equation trying to find solutions, and that's and many of the most relevant breakthroughs have actually been formulated by finding the right wave functions, good wave functions. Okay, so think about BCS, Abelian wave functions, and many more that we hear also already about this morning. And so far, but what is missing is the question is: is there really a systematic way of coming up with parameterizing wave functions? Okay, arising somehow for much more general classes, like is there, and these matrix products, it turns out that indeed they seem to parameterize all possible ground states of local Hamiltonians in one dimension. Okay, this is one of the reasons why it's so exciting. It's kind of unbiased. Okay, it works for any system. And this I think Matthew Hastings talked about this extensively last week, and also kind of tried to prove and kind of give evidence why this is the case. But still, I think it's important. This is one of the main. The main reasons why I think this whole concept of matrix box is exciting. Anyway, I would like to go to the more technical. So my lecture today will not focus that much on actually the applications or the physics or the on how to the physical applications of it, but just about the format. So the whole formalism of matrix boxes. And again, please interrupt me whenever. Any questions? So the first thing, so these matrix product operators have lots of connections with transfer matrices in classical spin systems, and I guess you're all familiar with this case. But let me just remind you how this works. So transfer matrices. Okay, so let's consider the partition function of Heisenberg. So this is now about, so the first part will purely be of classical system. There's nothing quantum here, but I will talk about. Let's consider the partition function somehow the sum of the configuration of your spins of the Ising model. Okay, so you have your Hamiltonian which couples spins on a lattice. Let's for the moment just consider it one-dimensional, so you have some kind of a one-dimensional. Of course you can do the same thing, two-dimensional, it doesn't matter. It will matter, of course, a lot for the physics, but formally the mathematical description is very simple. So you have a spin system, you have spins on every side, you're interacting via an Ising interaction, and you would like to calculate the partition function. So I will do this in a way that is a little bit complicated. Okay? There's certainly simpler ways of doing it for the one-dimensional case, but the way I will do it is important to do it like this, because then you also see how you can do this or how this will give rise to the concept of matrix product operators in two dimensions. Okay, so if you look at this object, you can interpret this as a matrix. Okay, this is a matrix. So these SIs, of course, they are like plus or minus 1 or 0 or 1, or doesn't really matter how you parameterize them. So, but this is this object here, so like if you write an exponential of delta SI SJ, you can interpret this as a matrix. Okay, so this is like e to the beta, e to the minus beta, e to the minus beta, e to the beta. Okay, so this is, and just this is, let's say, the row index, and this is the column index, or vice versa. It doesn't really matter because it's symmetric. And now there's a very simple kind of way of. So what we would like to do is to rewrite this kind of partition function as a product of matrices. Okay, that's the whole topic of transfer matrices in classical statistical physics. And a convenient way of doing this is actually by introducing some dual variables, actually some auxiliary variables, some extra variables. It's nothing more than actually writing this matrix as a product of two other matrices, okay, by introducing some kind of an extra index in between. And it's indeed this matrix, you can easily write it as some kind of a let's say cosine polycus of beta, polycus of beta, minus. So it's a very simple exercise. I'm just writing down the eigenvalue of the composition of the matrix. Sine polycus of beta minus sine polycus of beta times square root of sine. Okay, and this object here, so we will call it something like x, s, and then some extra index mu. Okay, so this object here, we call it x, let's say s, or whatever it's called, x, let's call it matrix A, s1, s2. And this, you can kind of take some eigenvalue decomposition or some square root, it doesn't really matter. You just want to kind of write this matrix as a product of different matrices. Okay, and this column, we write, so it's this times this plus this times this. You can also, say, of course, say that this is the matrix formed by this, and this times the matrix formed by this. It's just like you took a square root of your matrix. And now you define some kind of the matrix x, s, mu is equal to this kind of square root of cosine of beta. So what I'm doing here is just repeating what you have seen in your first course on statistical physics. Maybe not in this form, but it's really a very simple relation. And you do this, so you just define this matrix x as mu as this, then you can rewrite your partition function.
Are s and mu the indices of that matrix?
Yes. Okay. So s is, let's say, the row index, and mu is the column index.
And down here where you have s and mu, but you have a column.
Yeah, okay, actually, this was x, s, let's say minus 1, and this is x, s, plus 1. Okay, if you do this, then it's trivial to see that somehow you have to take some of these extra indexes that you introduce, these mu's, and also the sum over all these indices s times this x, s, i, you offer. Okay, so you see that indeed somehow the partition function can be expressed as a double sum of matrices. So you have to, of course, there's a product of all these matrices. But of course, this is a product. So every index in this product appears two times. Okay, so it appears because somehow you have this spin kind of is interacting with that one and with that one. And at the end, this set is nothing more than a product of matrices. So I see it somehow, I prepared these notes yesterday evening, so I see that actually I forgot to write the product in this in the notes. So anyway, so but this is pretty involved actually. If you write it out in pieces, it's like you easily get a little bit. Although it's pretty straightforward somehow. There's a much simpler way of dealing with this. Okay, and this is by working with diagrams. And this is something that that will come over again and again. If you want to understand the exploits, it's very useful instead of always writing these indices and kind of trying to see what indices have to be merged or kind of connected with which ones, is to draw simple kind of diagrams. Okay, what these diagrams mean is about what we'll do is just represent vectors, for example, like this. Okay, so this is an object with just one one open, so this is kind of an open index. Okay, we will call this x of mu, for example. We will represent it like this. Okay, so this dot here, it means it's a dead end, and this is kind of an open index. Okay, so the other thing, like if you have a matrix, x mu nu, this is nothing more than, let's say, a line. Okay, and if you want, you can put some kind of dot in between, but you see you have two open ends, so this would be the index mu, this would be the index mu. Okay, a tensor. Okay, for example, x, alpha, beta, gamma, delta, you would write it just like this. Okay, so, and if you want to represent multiplication of matrices within such a formalism, it's actually very straightforward. Okay, so for example, you want to represent the product of two matrices. So what you have is that you have one matrix like this, another matrix like this, and of course, the product of two matrices, you have to sum over this kind of index that they are a product. So this would be like x mu nu times times x mu mu prime. Okay, and of course, the product of these two matrices, you have to sum over mu. And then this is the way you represent it. So if two kind of, if you merge a line, okay, if a line is merged or is connected between two things, this is just means I take the sum over this index. Yeah, this is now index mu, this is index mu prime, and you see this is just another matrix. Okay, so this is, of course, again, some kind of something object like this. So this is the way we kind of will write or will use the algebra. Of course, you can do more complicated things in the nodes. So for example, you can multiply tensors with each other. You can kind of make constructions like this. Okay, so for example, in this case, you would kind of merge four tensors with each other, and you would sum over this index, this index, this index, and this index. Okay, and these kind of pictures will appear on and on, over and over again. So it's important that you understand this more. So this is like the center of your tensor, and if this line is connecting this tensor with this tensor, it means you have to sum over this index. It's like a matrix product. But this is just a generalization of matrix products of products of matrices to products of tensors. You're just contracting indices. So please interrupt me if it's not clear, because it's kind of for me, I've been working with these things for too long, so I don't realize anymore if it's completely trivial or not. But there's something that is not obvious. Okay, so let's try to reformulate what we did for this transfer matrices in the 1D case within basically this within this this language. So what we had was, for example, this central kind of object, this matrix B to minus B to minus B to B. If you write it like this, what we did is basically nothing more than replacing this matrix as something like a product of two matrices. And maybe I need to see if there's no, are there no colors of the? Not that it's important.
we have colored thin chalks on the table.
Okay, so this would, just to see, this would be somehow this index. This would be the index S, this would be the index mu, and this is the S prime. Okay, so kind of taking a square root of a matrix. Oh, thanks for it. So taking a square root of a matrix or something like that is like you replace this prime product of these things. And if you look at what this expression means in terms of such within this notation, this Z is kind of a product of many of these matrices. So if you look at, if you go back to this Z, what it will be is something like this. Line. Okay, and just the blue lines are these extra indices that we introduce, this kind of dual variables, or whatever you want to call it. This indices mu. This mu's are this. And yet you see this partition function in terms of these indices, I can very conveniently represent it as a product of matrices. And indeed somehow now you can kind of say, okay, let's look at this. For example, let's take this as my fundamental.
We use a quotient still, right?
Yeah, but it goes to infinity, let's say. Or whatever, it doesn't really matter. You can close, you have to define boundary conditions. So for the moment, I didn't define boundary conditions. Okay, you can either take closed boundary conditions or open boundary conditions.
No, but I mean that you leave it now open and it just, you know, and it has indices, you know.
Yeah, okay. So let's just close it.
You didn't need to do the factorization to write it this way.
No, I know, but you need to do it this way if you want to go to two dimensions. You need to kind of take the square roots because, and the reason is that if you have two dimensions, then this one index is appearing here, but also in these kind of different points, and you want to get rid of this index, and this is what we are doing here. So if you define now your fundamental object, let's call it mu. Mu now as the product of this times, so the product of this matrix times this matrix. Okay, so let's define this as being equal to this. Let's call this our fundamental matrix. So you see, it's always kind of the it's always the same matrix that is repeated, and then the Z is nothing more than this matrix A to the power n. Okay, and if you close the thing, then it's nothing more than the trace of this matrix A to the power n. Okay, and anyway, this matrix A, in this case, if you do the exercise for this, it would already be a diagonal matrix. Just 2 times cosine of the molecules of beta, 0, 0, 2 times sine of the molecules of beta. Okay, and
so which type, the blue and the white, which type?
So the blues were these extra indices that we introduced. Okay, so and somehow this A is nothing more than basically the sum, A mu nu, is the sum over this index S, which is the physical index of X S mu X S mu. Okay, because you see we obtained kind of a double sum. So anyway, for the people, I don't think anybody's lost, but if you would be lost, it's not that kind of crucial. That, yeah.
Why is there a blue line? What's the difference between the blue and the blue?
Well, it just, so we introduced an extra variable, an extra index. But you will see if you do it in two dimensions, you have to kind of introduce this kind of extra variables, otherwise you cannot reformulate the constant matrix problem in terms of. You can actually not define your constant matrices in any way that makes sense if you don't introduce extra variables. So this A is called the transfer matrix for the zero array, for the one-dimensional kind of classical isomorphism. And what you see is that indeed somehow transfer matrices of classical systems. So we started with some kind of Hamiltonian, this is an exponential beta of this, Well, this also, in principle, this is a problem that you could think as exponential complexity, because I have to sum over exponentially many different configurations, because this SIs, they all kind of, all of them run between minus one and one, and if you have n sites, it is exponentially many configurations that you have to sum over. But you see that somehow there's a neat trick by deformulating things in terms of transfer matrices to reduce this complexity from exponential to polynomial. Now this is exactly what will also be done in this whole kind of matrix product state picture. You start from a wave function that is defined on a Hilbert space with exponentially many kind of variables. Somehow what you do is deformulate a wave function for which calculating expectation values or calculating anything will become equivalent to just calculating the partition function of a classical model in the same dimension. So if you start from your kind of this whole matrix product, the difficulty of calculating expectation values with matrix product states is equivalent to calculating the partition functions of classical one-dimensional systems. And that's why somehow I'm just sketching these kind of trivial things, but you will see that somehow if you, the algebra or the manipulation or working with matrix product states, there's nothing more difficult than multiplying matrices with each other. Okay, so, but before we do this, let's go to two dimensions. Okay, let's try to understand what is going on in two dimensions. So we do the same thing. Okay, so what we have here is the partition function. It was sum of SI, exponential, all these kind of things. But instead of a one-dimensional line, we have like a complete lattice. Okay, so we have a two-dimensional lattice. Let's do it for the square lattice. Okay, and for example, this index S, you have a term in your notorium that connects this S to that one, to that one, to that one, and to that one. But what you do is introduce these kind of additional variables that basically, so there will be one additional variable here, mu, or let's call it whatever, alpha, beta, gamma, delta, just in the same way as we did here. And it's basically completely equivalent. The only thing that will happen now is that this, instead of this a mu nu with two indices, we'll end up with something like an a alpha, beta, gamma, delta, which is just like we have the sum here of an S, X, S, mu, X, S, nu. We'll have to take the sum over S of the X, S alpha, X, S beta, X, S gamma, X, S delta. Okay, because somehow the only thing that we are doing is we rewrite kind of these terms by introducing these extra variables, and then we implicitly take the sum over these S, and we get these kind of objects A, alpha, beta, gamma, delta, which is nothing more than something like this in our notation. Actually, if I would follow the notation here, it should be blue lines, but there will only be blue lines. Anyway, doesn't matter. And therefore, somehow, the calculation of the partition function of the two-dimensional classical Ising model is completely equivalent to contracting a tensor network. Okay, well, this is a tensor network, no? It's actually completely the same as this one. But now the difference, so this picture was not, you should not interpret it in terms of these diagrams actually. This is the lattice that I was drawing here. Okay, by going to these dual variables, we see that somehow calculating the partition function becomes equivalent to just contracting somehow a network, somehow all tensors. Okay, this is this index, let's say, where this index alpha, beta, gamma, delta. You have all these indices everywhere. The only thing is this index here has to be identified with the index here, and you have to contract it. It's just like what we saw here. So you have a tensor, all different tensors, and contracting them over these tensors is nothing more than multiplying or kind of identifying the indices. And you see that indeed calculating the partition function is nothing more than contracting this tensor network. Okay, is that, I'm going too fast, or Steve?
So is it okay to think of these extra indices as just being SI times SJ as a simple way to picture what
I think they are rather these, I've never figured it out, but I think they are related to these, to the way that Castellan and Fortuyn and these kind of people are doing. They introduce some kind of extra variables. So what I've been doing here is completely trivial. I'm not just rewriting this partition function. I'm just taking a square root. And I'm taking a square root because somehow the problem is that this S here is connected to that one, to that one, to that one, and to that one. And I don't want to have an index that is connected with four things because I cannot take a product of these different objects. So what I want to do is to take kind of square root such that there's only one index connecting different things to each other. And I take the sum over these s of these kind of things. So it's nothing more than a trick. But implicitly in the way that Onsager and these people did it, they did this. Okay, there's nothing new or anything. They knew perfectly well, I think the first ones to understand it were Carlos and Monnier, that indeed calculating the partition function of the two-dimensional classical Ising is equivalent to can be reformulated in terms of eigenvectors of transfer matrices. And I've never gone through their papers, but somehow implicitly what they have been doing must be possible to reformulate like this, but suppose this is a very kind of convenient or easy way to do it.
Could you draw how the x variables are connected in the 2D case? I mean, the 1D case is still how you separate them, but how do you do it in the 2D case?
Yeah, exactly. So these are the tensors. Okay. This is the basic building block. This one. Okay. This is the basic building block. And I put one here. I put one there. I put one there. I put one there. So for example, let's just to sketch you. I have one object like this. Okay. So what would this mean? So I have something like, let's call this alpha, beta, gamma, delta, epsilon, zeta, eva. Okay, and this thing, what does that mean, that object? This is the sum over delta, over A, alpha, beta, gamma, delta, times A, delta, epsilon, zeta, eva. Okay, this is what it means. I just contract this index. Just means I take the sum over that index. Yes?
Yeah, maybe, I don't know, maybe that was the question, maybe how you get the x as alpha. I mean, you do the same thing as you do 1D. Yes, yeah, the same thing. You take this link, and then you split it up in a product of two matrices.
Indeed.
And that's this x as alpha.
Yeah, this x as alpha is really the one that we don't
know. Decouple these spins via different. So you could do this for any partition function. Right?
So any
classical. I mean, yeah, I can have very funny, functions of these spins. You can always write it.
So it doesn't have to be transition invariant or anything. So any classical partition function, you can use this trick and map it. You can see that actually calculating this partition function is equivalent to contracting this whole answer.
Yeah, and it doesn't need to be an exponent, right? It's just a matrix that depends, has indices, right?
Yeah, of course, this is just an arbitrary kind of. So this, it just has to be some matrix that only depends on these indices.
Yeah.
So at the end, we didn't make use of the fact that this is an exponential or anything, of course not. This is just any matrix that can be. So there's always something like a single. You can always. So the only thing is you have to take something like a square root of that matrix. But this is possible for any matrix.
Yeah, but then it's in, yeah. Okay, I guess that's yeah.
So you can always. It doesn't have to be the left side. Does not be equal to the right side. For example, you can have x times mu, x times y, or something.
Yeah,
like
it doesn't even confuse.
Yes.
I saw matrices here, right? So how do you form this A tensor with this these x's? Because you have four of these node
beams. Indeed. So this is. So I have. This is the same index here. This s is the same as this one. Is the same as this one.
So can you graphically show how these are connected with the x's?
Show the four x graphs.
You can just draw them on your cross there, but show the x's.
Yeah,
the x's.
Yeah, can you
make the A terms of x's?
Okay, so let's call this. So this is x alpha, and let's say s is just a label.
Yes.
And then somehow this is one of them, and then you just take the sum over this s of this, and this is this. Because I don't know what to.
So I mean, in the 2D case, you can actually draw the contracting of the index. But in this case, there's no contracting, or doesn't.
No. Indeed, that's why I'm explicitly taking the sum. Okay, there's no real. That's the thing, because this is not a matrix. This is not a matrix multiplication or anything, no? Because you have four objects.
Yeah, matrix multiplication is two things like this. And this
so it's just a coincidence that in one dimension somehow indeed this contraction is equivalent, but in two dimensions that's not the case. You have explicitly to take this up. Yeah, because there's nothing like a matrix multiplication that works, that is defined for tensors.
So given an Ising model, can you show us how to get this x? In 2D.
Yes.
Yeah, that's the same as that.
So for that formula, to the to the left hand side you have Si and Sj. To the right hand side, can you show us which one is Si, which one is Sj?
So this is the index S and this is the index mu.
Yes.
The XS alpha times XS prime alpha is that coefficient. We have multiple,
so no rest. So since this polynomial matrix is equal to X times X transpose. The boundary conditions. So the easiest case is like I also mentioned. Of course, if you have periodic boundary conditions, okay, then somehow you just have to close this thing. If you don't have periodic boundary conditions, if you have open boundary conditions, then somehow. Okay, let's run this for open boundary conditions. Then the whole thing would look like this. So somehow these tensors at the boundary would be different. Okay, the tensors that you would get here, for example, it would only be a sum over three of those guys. Because you only have three indices, alpha, beta, and gamma. There's only one, two, and three. There's no one, so you don't have to take the sum over. So this tensor here would be the one would be defined like this, the sum over S of X, S alpha, X, S beta, S gamma. Okay, this one, for example, the corner would only have two. This would be equivalent to actually what we're doing. So this is how you treat, how you deal with boundaries. Yes?
So
you're
going to the case where you have only boundary
interactions,
the nearest neighbor interactions,
yes,
on the left. If I would have next nearest neighbor interactions, would it work the same?
Yeah, then so then it becomes actually. I've not tried to work it out even because it becomes much more complicated. And I don't. Yeah, it's certainly still possible because you can introduce somehow the if you have next nearest neighbor interactions. So what you see is that these indices, these alphas, alpha, beta, gamma, delta. They run over the physical index. So if you have the Ising model, these alphas, they just are minus 1 and 1. If you would have a Potts model or something like that, with 5 states, then these alphas, they would just have to run from 1 to 5. Okay, so they correspond to the physical. If you would have next nearest neighbor interactions, my intuition tells me that these alphas would have to run between 1 and the square of the, would probably have to run, in the case of the Ising, it would be enough to choose them between 1 and 4. Yeah, but somehow this is because you can always, yeah. Anyway, I don't want to explain it, but it's possible. But if you,
yeah, I think this is nice in the sense that it also shows why it's simple in 1D because it's just matrix multiplication and then you're going to large eigenvalues of that little matrix. Whereas in 2D it's a tensor abstraction,
yes,
which is already not an eigenvalue composition you can do.
Okay, so but anyway, so you see that the partition factor, the partition function of a classical spin system in two dimensions is not trivial. You have to contract a tensor network. And actually the computational complexity, Barbara and Ashwin will certainly talk about this, of contracting such a tensor network is actually sharp P hard or whatever. It's even harder than it be complete. So in principle, if I give you arbitrary tensors, and I ask you, contract this network, okay, just do these multiplications. It's actually a problem that is intractable. Okay, it's intractable in the worst case. Okay, in practice, however, there's many cases where it just works well, but this is well known. I think it was first shown by, what's his name again, the guy that worked with IBM, Barahona?
Yeah.
And indeed, calculating the partition function of the two-dimensional classical Ising with random interactions. Okay, that copy in this partition thing is an NP hard problem. And of course, by this kind of method, what we just did, you can immediately translate this problem to contracting this tensor network. This is equivalent to that in the partition function. Therefore, somehow, for arbitrary, if you put arbitrary tensors there, it should be a hard problem. Now, in practice, it just turns out that in many cases it works. But anyway, so what is the next step that's unsargeted? Implicitly, unsargeted did these kind of steps. I don't think he did it in the way I just explained it, but implicitly it's all there. What you see is that if you have a big system, a system that goes to the thermodynamic limit, so this goes to infinity, this goes to infinity, but somehow this S, just like somehow the partition function here was the trace of a matrix, the same matrix to the power n, this is also somehow the trace of a big matrix, let's call it O, to the power n when n goes to infinity. Okay, and what is this matrix O in this case? This matrix O is some object that looks like this. Yeah, that's this is the ghost notion. Okay, so it's always the same. So you just take one column basically out of this tensor network. You define it as O. You take this O, take it to a very large power, take the trace of this, this is the partition function. Okay, so in this particular case, the way I set it up, actually this O is actually a Hermitian matrix. Okay, we know that indeed if you take a matrix, take it to a very, very large power, and take a trace of this, and this is nothing more if n goes to infinity than the largest eigenvalue of that matrix to the power n. Okay, so we see that indeed calculating the partition function of the 2D classical Ising is equivalent to finding the largest eigenvalue of this this object that I wrote down here, this object O, which is a matrix product operator.
Yes, please. So what you call O there is what you call T in your hands?
I don't know.
Yes,
let's call it T dot. The tensor.
But that T is just you do that matrix, the contraction, you do it on the line basically, and then you get that T. Right? You do this L, these A.
So what I say is that just like this thing is the product of this times this times this, I'm just doing the same. I say, okay, this whole object is nothing more than the product of always the same kind of matrix that I multiply by each other. And, but this matrix is itself kind of an infinite object. Okay? And this is what we call a matrix product operator. I will explain you why this is called a matrix product operator. So anyway, so what Hansager did in his very famous paper is exactly calculating this eigenvalue of the largest eigenvalue, the largest eigenvalue of your...
Were you saying this is generically not for
Hermitian? No, no. So generically for... yeah. There is no reason why this has to be a Hermitian. Okay, so let's focus, so, because this is actually the central topic. So you see, these tensor matrices, or these matrix product operators, these are the basic building blocks that we are talking about. Okay? This is, they appear very naturally in the context of classical partition functions. So what is this T? Okay, let's, so following the notes, we'll just write it down. You can as well, of course, turn it all over its head. So these are kind of, if you interpret this as a matrix, these are the incoming indices, and these are the outgoing indices. Okay, that's why it's a matrix. Okay, this is a very efficient, so the dimension of this matrix, if you would have n points here in the case of the Ising, the dimension of this matrix is 2 to the n times 2 to the n. And why is this? If we go somehow, this index can have values 0 and 1, this index can have a value 0 and 1, and so further. So you see indeed, somehow this is a matrix. So we have an efficient parameterization of a matrix, at least in a 2 to the n times 2 to the n dimensional Hilbert space. Normally you cannot write down the matrix, but using somehow this notation, it's obvious what it is. And if you would actually write it out explicitly, this is nothing more than the trace, the sum of I1, I2, and so further, A, I1, A, I2, A, I n, times O, I1, tensor, O, I2, tensor. Now what are these O's? These O's are operators. So this O is, for example, an operator that acts on these two indices. Okay, this is the kind of the first qubit you can think of. This index here, this O, this operator here, is acting on these two qubits. Okay. These operators are basically the operators that that parameterize somehow how are these different operators connected with each other. So in this case, I actually use periodic boundary conditions. So you have to identify this index with this index. Okay, it turns out that if you did the calculation somehow and you define this, just to see what is written in the notes, square root of cosine hyperbolic is delta plus minus square root of sine hyperbolic is delta. Then somehow these indices A plus minus is nothing more than x plus minus x plus minus. Okay, so there's a very simple parameterization of these matrices, and actually they are also equal to the O's. Okay, Okay, this is now the first time that we indeed see somehow why is this called a matrix product operator. It's because this is a trace of a product of matrices, and every one of these matrices has an extra index. This index is connected to these kind of operators that act on your physical space. Okay? Because somehow this dimension, these are kind of virtual indices. You don't see them anymore because they are traced out. The matrix only acts from here to here, and these are these outs. Okay, but I guess most of you have already seen matrix product states. I don't know whether you have seen matrix product operators. The matrix product state is nothing more than you would just not have these upper indices, only the lower ones. But it's basically the same. Instead of having vectors here, you have operators. Okay, this is called a matrix product.
So I2 is both the two, the index going up and the index going down?
Yes.
So it's a compact notation for.
So for example, this I2 with. For example, what this could be is the sigma alpha, for example, the Pauli matrices. So this I2 would be the notation for the. This. So the same, for example, I2 means sigma. If I2 is 0, then this means the identity. If I2 is 1, this is sigma x. If I2 is 2, it's sigma y. And it's 3, it's sigma z, for example. It's just a label of an operator. This index is not has nothing to do. So this.
You say the operator has two indices. You know, this is not.
Yeah, this is an operator. This operator has two indices, but I didn't write down any of them.
Right.
No, it's an operator.
So you can keep a happy one. But the right is with that you know, O has mu mu and mu is above
it. What is the index you wrote down?
Because I sum over these indices.
Summing.
I'm summing over this, and this is how I define it.
Of course, those A's have nothing to do with, well, they're somehow related, they're not equal to these A's, there's some A's to them.
Yeah, actually, it's a different A's.
Yeah, right.
But you say this is an operator,
actually. But that T seems like
it's one of the other T's. So this D, that's why it's much easier actually to see it in the graphic notation. This D is nothing more than this. This is
right.
D.
Yeah. So T is.
Yeah.
Product of a whole bunch of these
things.
Yeah, you
contract
that and write it down.
Yeah, so well, this A then is like a square root of this A or something like that. So maybe I should have used the B. But it's just because it's written in the notes with an A and B. Okay, so these are matrices now with an extra label. So this object AI has, of course, this mu and this mu. But somehow this you take the product of these matrices and then sum over these things now. But anyway, I think all of you have seen matrix product states, so it should be clear what this means. Now what is important? Okay, so it turns out that these matrix product operators they will appear everywhere, and that's what I will try to sketch. Maybe I should use some. So what are the algebraic, or how do you can you calculate with this matrix product operator? So what are kind of the very simple properties that they have? It's maybe that the product of two matrix product operators is itself a matrix product operator. So if you take a matrix product operator and you take the product with another one, and this of course these lines. This means I explicitly take the sum of this, so this is the product of two matrices. This itself is a new matrix product operator. The only thing that happens is actually that the dimension of these matrices that you need to represent them is squared, because instead of just having one kind of index, so these are the indices, so these indices here are the indices of these matrices. Okay, so if you take the product of two matrix product operators, you get, again, one big matrix product operator by just identifying. You say, okay, these two, this whole thing, it's nothing more. I can write this as one thing here, but I just have to, if this is the index mu and nu, I just merge these two indices into one. So you see that indeed, if I take the product of two matrix product operators, I get a new matrix product operator of this kind. But where the dimension of these bonds is now squared. Okay, because I have and a new and a new, now I have to take both of them. Okay, and if you, so this has to, let's say this goes from 0 to 1, and this goes from 0 to 1, then these two indices together go from, there's four they go from 1 to 4. That's, so this is, so you see that indeed the product of the matrix product operators is again a matrix product operator, but the dimension of this kind of hidden index is squared. Okay? And this index is exactly the dimension of these matrices. And this dimension of these matrices is the crucial or the kind of central thing in the MRG. This is this kind of number of states that you keep or whatever you want to call it. This is related to this dimension of these to the dimension of these of this index. Now another very important property that that we will come back to is the fact that that this representation of a matrix product operator, or for the same amount of money for a matrix product state, is not unique. Okay, because you see, this is defined as a trace of a product of matrices. Okay, therefore, somehow there's different representations. There's some kind of gauge transformation that I can do that leave my object, my transfer matrix, invariant. But somehow the matrices A change. Okay, how do you do this? So you see that somehow if it's obvious that somehow this is, so I have to take many products of this, but this is obviously equal to something like, I put some kind of, I multiply here with the matrix X, and I multiply here with the matrix X minus 1. This is obviously the same kind of object. I have here an index, I multiply with this matrix X, multiply with X minus 1. So therefore, somehow, instead of working with this as the basic building block, I could as well have used that thing. Okay, and then somehow for this one, I could have used that thing. So you see, this is kind of a gauge transformation on your matrices, and it gives you exactly the same state. Okay, it gives you exactly the same physical state. And actually, it's very important to exploit these kind of gauge transformations if you want to get an efficient kind of matrix product state algorithm. So implicitly in the way that Steve White invented his DMRG, he's always choosing and he's always making a very smart choice of how do I choose this X. Okay, and by choosing this X, he effectively always makes sure that somehow the vectors are all orthonormal. Okay, and that's but for this you really have to do this gauge transformation. And you see this somehow in these matrix product operator formulas, we immediately see indeed that there's no unique way of representing a matrix product state. There's many different ways of representing the same matrix product state. So this gauge transformation, what it does is, for example, this AI would go to AI times X. Okay, this is because somehow this object here is not acting on the physical indices, it's only acting on these kind of virtual indices that you have in the line, in the line listing.
I guess you can show that
that's
the only
freedom. Yeah, under some extra conditions, yes, if it's injective. Obviously, also these matrices, they don't have to be the same everywhere. No? In practice, if you run the MRG, all these matrices here will be different. So this will become some kind of, but whatever. So what is a matrix product state? To come back and within this kind of notation, the matrix product state is nothing more than this. Okay, this is the matrix product state. So you only have one outgoing index. Okay, and in this case, somehow these operators, so for example, what this would be is sum i1 to in, the trace, the trace is when you take really boundary conditions, a i1, a i2, A I n times I 1 minus and so forth. And the dimension of these matrices, is exactly the dimension of that link.
And then the I's run the number of values the I sub n has
is the physical dimension. Oh, this I's run over the, like if you have a system of string models,
the physical dimension of that.
Yes.
Of that. Yes.
So this I is then over the physical dimension, but the trace is over matrices of dimension d by d. Okay, these matrices are d by d matrices. Or m by n use. Now, what is a very important property of these matrix product states is that you can calculate the norm or the expectation value of a matrix product operator very efficiently using a matrix product state. So, given a matrix product state, okay, you could say, okay, let's take a transfer matrix and a matrix product state, can I calculate its expectation value, or can I calculate the overlap? So what, how would you, so what would be the notation in this language of psi t psi? So how would this be? It's would be nothing more than something like this. Okay, so this would be kind of this upper part would be psi. And you multiply with this object in the middle, which is domain exponent operator, and then you contract all the remaining indices with the conjugate of psi. I don't know if this is clear. So this is how you calculate the expectation values of a matrix plot operator with respect to matrix plot state. Now, if you see this, you immediately see that it needs calculating this. How do you calculate this thing? I think it's probably obvious to all of you that indeed this kind of tensor network can be contracted efficiently. Because this is nothing more than the partition function of a classical spin system. There's no free indices here anymore. Remember, the classical Ising what we had was just kind of a line. And we just had to have products of matrices. Now, what this is that you just identify, let's say, this object here. You identify it as one of these kind of objects. You just identify it as this. So these three indices, you merge them into one. These three, you merge them into one. And then this whole thing is nothing more than the product of matrices. And therefore, indeed, calculating expectation values of matrix product states. Or, for example, if you calculate the norm of a matrix product state, it's even simpler. If you have psi psi, this is equal, then it's just a double. This is the norm you calculate like this. So this is equivalent to kind of multiplying matrices with each other, which is efficient, okay? Because these matrices, they have dimension d by d. So in this case, somehow, this would be d, and somehow, let's say, in the case of the matrix or operator of for the Ising, this would be 2. So this matrix would be a 2d, so this would be a 2d squared times 2d squared matrix. Okay? And you multiply this matrix with each other, always the same, and somehow that's... Therefore, that's also the reason why we can go to the thermodynamic limit. So it's possible to reformulate or to formulate a DMRG kind of method in the thermodynamic limit, because we can still calculate expectation values there. If all these kind of matrices are equal to each other, then calculating such an expectation value is, again, nothing more than calculating the largest eigenvalue of that matrix. But that matrix is now a very simple finite dimensional matrix. So it's just a linear algebra kind of problem. Only a 2d squared times 2d squared matrix.
In terms of doing it optimally, the 2d squared by 2d squared matrix multiply would be 8d to the 6th.
Yes.
And so you could show them what...
Yes, I can show that. Yes. Okay, so in practice, if you... Let's focus on this example. Okay, this is a bit simpler. So how would you calculate... So indeed, naively, to calculate the norm of the matrix product state, you would think that the cost would scale like d to the 4. So with normal matrix product states, so the way DMRG works is that you always choose some kind of a simple boundary. Okay? So that means that this object here, there's no links that link it to the other side. This is how DMRG works. So you have a vector. You have to multiply this vector with that matrix. Okay, this is a matrix, a vector times a matrix. So what is the cost of multiplying a vector? So you have a vector times this. And this is a d squared by d squared matrix. And this vector is kind of a d squared because it has two indices. We just interpreted it as one common index. So multiplying a vector with a matrix, what is the cost that you would expect? To expect that the cost is d to the 4. But actually, what is already, all of this is of course implicit in these DMRG methods. You don't, there's a smarter way of calculating, of contracting this. Multiplying this vector with this tensor, the way you will do it is first merge this index. Okay? And only after you have merged that index, then merge that index. So first sum over this index, and then sum over that index. And if you do that, you see that the cost is equal to d cubed instead of d to the 4. Therefore, somehow, if you really implement these algorithms in practice, you really have to do this kind of multiplication. If you multiply this kind of tensor networks with each other, you have to do it in a smart way. You don't have to kind of join these indices and then treat it as a vector. No, you treat this as kind of different indices, and you kind of only merge one index by one, and you do it in a way that is kind of the most convenient, and then you can always get it, because this gives you a huge speed up in practice. Is this what
That was the idea. And then, of course, the other thing is that the physical index is small, so we don't even have to.
Yes, indeed. So the physical index, this one, as in the case of spin 1/2, this one, this index is typically like this. This means this index here is typically, in the case of spin 1/2, this is just two dimensional. So this index has only two values. While this index here is this D, which can be very large. I don't know, what is the largest calculation that has been done? 10,000?
10,000.
Yeah, so there's people that take this index 10,000, but this is in quantum chemistry, I think. Okay, but this is of course one of the crucial and very important properties of matrix product states is that there's an algebra and you can actually manipulate these things and you can calculate expectation values very efficiently. Okay, so you could say, okay, why is it that somehow you took all the trouble of defining transfer matrices? Yes?
I missed something really basic here. So earlier you said this problem of evaluating tensor network contractions with sharp P.
Yes.
And you're saying it's efficient, but it's only efficient with respect to these matrix product states.
So, in two dimensions, this is big, and you would like to, you would say, okay, let's evaluate, let's contract this tensor network. So what is the naive way is, okay, you say, okay, this is like a one-dimensional problem, I just have to merge all these indices with each other. But what is the dimension then of these matrices? It becomes like if this dimension is d, and there's n of them, then the dimension of this matrix is d to the n, which is exponential. That's why it's exponential. Okay, but here this is a one-dimensional problem. There's no this doesn't extend. There's only kind of three or two, so it doesn't grow.
So it's efficient for a fixed d.
Fixed.
Yes.
Yes. So the thing that looks like a two-legged ladder, if you did it the efficient way, you got a d cubed. And then if you did it with the thing that looks like a three-legged ladder,
yes,
then that would come up the efficient way with d to the fourth.
No. Actually, it depends on the dimension. Because typically the
operator
we will put in between is much smaller.
Yeah.
This would be the Hamiltonian.
We assume it was just for simplicity. We assume it was a d also.
Yes.
Then it will be d to the fourth, I think.
Oh, if it's a d, yeah, actually.
And then you would see
automatically.
That
might be d to the, yeah. It's easy to work.
Yeah. But then you would see that it would scale up in the 2D case to d to the n or something.
Yes.
Yeah. And so then you.
So even in the efficient way, you always have an exponential scale. That's
just. I'm still confused about the regular thing. When you wrote the matrix product state, the indices hanging down are the physical indices.
Yes.
Okay. And then you contract it with the T, the matrix product operator, and that's got indices going up and indices going down. And I don't see them over there in that formula, so they're just not displayed.
Okay, so
here you call them I1 through IN.
So these O's here are like poly. Just imagine that these O's are the poly matrices.
So maybe it's a notational thing. Here you're using I1 through IN for the physical indices. And
yes.
Over there, you're not. They're not.
No, these are different.
Yeah, that is the problem.
Okay.
I think you have a mu,
right, okay.
And then mu
like
equals
like
mu equals
I
in that
okay.
case.
Mu 2.
Okay. And of course, these A's are different
yeah,
than those A's are different from these A's. Right?
But the thing is, in practice, we don't care about the indices because we always go in these kind of pictures where it's kind of.
And those A's are not the same as those A's.
No.
Nor are the same as those A's. Okay.
Okay, but so you see that these matrix product operators, certainly in classical statistical physics, they play a central role. Well, that's how you write partition functions of problems in statistical physics. Let me now show that actually a Hamiltonian in a one-dimensional Hamiltonian, like the Heisenberg model or something like that, in 1D, can also exactly be written as a matrix product operator. So it's not just classical partition, classical kind of problems that can be reformulated as so you immediately see somehow that indeed the variational problem now, if you want to find, let's go back to the partition, so to the problem of calculating the partition function. Problem of calculating the partition function is finding basically is maximizing that quantity over all possible sizes. This is because this is, if T is Hermitian, this is by definition the largest eigenvalue of your partition function. As we saw, indeed, somehow partition function is related the largest eigenvalue of your partition function. This is the variational principle that, well, the largest eigenvalue of a matrix is nothing more than the overlap, the maximum of the overlap of a matrix with all possible vectors. This is only true for condition operators, but that's what we consider now. This is the problem of calculating the largest the partition function. In the case of quantum, quantum Hamiltonian, like the Heisenberg model or the Hubble problem 1D or anything, so the only thing that we want to do is to replace this with a Hamiltonian and to write a minimum here. Okay, because you're interested in the ground state. That doesn't make any difference. And what we'll see is that indeed a Hamiltonian, any Hamiltonian in one dimension, can actually exactly be written as a matrix product operator with very low bond dimension also.
Well, not everyone, right? I mean, we know there are
interactions.
What? No, but we know there are Hamiltonians, one-dimensional quantum Hamiltonians, for which the ground state problem is hard. So they have to respond to bond dimension.
But if you don't, here I don't restrict this psi to be whatever. So of course, we will restrict, in practice, we will restrict these psi's to be matrix product states with a certain bond dimension. Again, it just happens that there exist Hamiltonians for which the bond dimension that you need to achieve to get enough accuracy grows too fast. But somehow, it's still true that this is the variational problem that we'll solve. Get these matrix products, but I will argue, the time is going very fast, I will try to argue why indeed somehow matrix product states are very good candidates, or kind of very natural candidates for ground states of such Hamiltonians.
Maybe you're going to say that now, are you going to show that any like one-dimensional quantum Hamiltonian can be viewed as this tensor? This operator, this matrix products operator with low bond dimension?
So what I want to show is that any take the Heisenberg model with nearest neighbor interactions in 1D, this can be written as a matrix product operator. And in that case, this bond dimension here, this D is equal to 4 or 5.
Yes. But do you know a general thing?
It's 5.
Is a general thing like that true?
So any local Hamiltonian
can be written
with nearest neighbor interactions can be written as something like this with bond dimension 5, in the case of Spinman house. And actually you can also, the nice thing is that the same formula allows you to have long range interactions with exponential decay. So actually any Hamiltonian that is of the form H is some over alpha, and I is more than J, or something like mu alpha lambda alpha to the power I minus J times sigma alpha I times sigma alpha J plus the sum of some local terms. Okay, so just to say, so this is like, in the case of the Heisenberg model, you would not have this term and all these mu's would be 1, so this would be xx plus yy plus cz, and you wouldn't have any local form. Okay, but somehow what I allow here is actually for also like a Heisenberg interaction with exponentially decaying interactions. Okay, so you have, somehow I have a Heisenberg interaction with strength 1 between these two, but I have a Heisenberg interaction with strength lambda squared. Okay, that's the lambda squared between these two and lambda cubed between these two. So you have some kind of an exponentially decaying interaction, a Heisenberg interaction. That Hamiltonian can also be written as this one with one dimension 5. Okay, so it's possible to incorporate really Hamiltonians that are not just purely local, that have some kind of fast enough decaying interactions, exactly like matrix product
operators. You can have the near neighbor term plus the exponential, right? The exponential doesn't give you the near neighbor term.
No, it gives you because it's the strongest, let's say. Nearest neighbor would be lambda, the next nearest neighbor would be lambda squared.
The general form you get with this is the near neighbor term is one piece of a matrix product, and then the extra ones with the lambda come in as a separate piece. You can have.
Yeah, of course, but you can also get sums of Hamiltonians like this. So there's also some kind of code, but I didn't. So the sum of two matrix product operators is obviously also a matrix product operator. If you take this plus a matrix product operator, and this is also a matrix product operator, and the only thing that happens is that this bond dimension, instead of kind of squaring it, it's not just the sum, the dimension is just the sum of operators.
Right, but with the same D equals 5, you get both T terms.
Yeah, maybe. I forgot this. But anyway, there's actually a simple way of doing this, but I see that time is running fast, so I'm not so sure that I want to sketch it. But so the there's actually a simple there's a simple way. So this Hamiltonian can be written as the sum of trace A I 1, A I 2, A I n times, let's say, x I 1 tensor, x I 2 tensor. So this is just a matrix product, I'm just repeating the matrix product. And in this case, the x x 0, actually these are nothing more than the Pauli matrices. Okay, these are the Pauli matrices, let's say, with x0 is equal to, sigma 0 is the identity, and then you have x, y, and z, so you have four different ones. And then these matrices A, or in my notes, they are called B. They have some kind of a simple form, okay, so this, so you can just read them in the notes. It's you just have to believe me, and there's a generic way of constructing Hamiltonians like this. The only thing that is important is indeed somehow this Hamiltonian can be written like this. Okay, it is a matrix product operator. Let's see. I will certainly not manage to get it to the beta bus, but how much time do we have? 20 minutes? Or has anybody some strong urge to understand how the algebraic beta ansatz can be formulated in this language?
It sounds interesting, but I don't know if you can do that in 20 minutes.
I can do that in 20 minutes, but then of course I cannot. So.
Well, what are the other questions that people like
what
ask?
What are the other options?
I mean, we could also, are there questions? Do people believe they understood?
Yeah, but maybe the best thing is now to continue a little bit about in this line and give you some evidence why actually, if you want to do this variation, that matrix product state makes sense. That they would give you, that they are a reasonable kind of approximation, or that they will give reasonable results for as a variational ansatz. These matrix product states are actually reasonable ansatzes for eigenstates, extremal eigenstates of matrix product operators. That's what I want to where I want to give you some evidence for. Okay, so let's consider. It doesn't matter now, okay? So now Hamiltonians, transfer matrices.
So now here, since this is the Pauli matrices, the I's just take on the four values.
Yes, indeed.
That's all. Yes.
And these B's, these are matrices, 5 by 5 matrices.
And that's just four because the indices are I'sing, or
indeed,
two state indices, and the Pauli matrices is a complete set of matrices.
Yes.
So
of course, if you would,
why do you only put Hermitian?
It's because it's Hamiltonian.
Right, and you're saying you break it up this way. The full thing is Hermitian, and each little part also has to be.
I agree that, but this is not necessary. Of course, you could put things like creational and relational.
But if you keep
there,
only Hermitian parts there, this sum will generate all Hermitian.
Yes, sir. And in fact, of course, you can also put creational and relational operators there if you want. It doesn't. So if you would take the Ising Hamiltonian, let's say you only have xx plus z, then these guys would only have, I think, then you would never need a y or something like that.
Right.
So there's this. So just the bottom dimension then would also be only 3 or 4 or something. I think it would only be 3 actually. Okay, so but it doesn't. Now, what we have seen is that indeed the Hamiltonian. So what is the variational problem now? Both if you want to calculate partition function of classical systems, or you want to kind of calculate expectation to find ground set of Hamiltonians, you can reformulate it as the variational problem. Minimum or maximum overall psi, the psi, the scale is h, but this h is now a general matrix problem operator. Okay, so this is the problem we want to solve. But now let's consider that we have a gap homotopy. Okay, let's, it can even be in the time I did it, but we have a gap homotopy. Then you have a matrix. So somehow you have a matrix. Let's call it O. T, T is what we call it. You have T. And you're interested in, let's say, the eigenvalue with the largest magnitude of that operator. In linear algebra, there's a very simple way of kind of getting there. Okay, so it's basically nothing more than like imaginary time evolution. You just multiply this thing with each other. T times T times T times T. And if you have a gap, then the number of times you have to multiply these matrices with each other will not be very, very large. It will be related to somehow how big is the gap. And if the gap is pretty large, then with a very few multiplications of these matrices, all the kind of sub-leading eigenvectors will kind of be, their contribution will kind of become exponentially small. Okay, so if T is large enough, then this is basically nothing more than the extremal eigenvector that you're interested in. The thing is, if you have a gapped system, you don't have to multiply these things very much to get already quite some good overlap with the exact construct. Okay, so you get some operator that has a good overlap. Now, what is this T? So it doesn't matter. So what if you? So this is called the power method. Okay, this is in linear algebra. This is known. This is just one specific way of finding eigenvectors of Hamiltonians. You just multiply the matrices, and here you start with an arbitrary state. Okay, so. Call it high. It doesn't matter. You just start with an arbitrary state. This can be a product state. Apply this T several times, and you know that somehow you get a better and better overlap with the ground state or the extremal eigenvector that you're interested in. Now, what is this thing itself? So, this thing is, for example, you start with the product state. This would be somehow really this thing. No, it's just a product. There's no. Then you apply this T. Okay, then you apply it several times. And this is, let's say, you applied it here three times. And you know that you already get some kind of a reasonable overlap with your ground state. But as we have seen, this is nothing more than a matrix product state. Okay? Because somehow this is due to the algebra. If you multiply two things with each other, you get another matrix product state, the matrix product property. Of course, the dimension, the bond dimension of your matrix product state grows exponentially with the number of times that you apply this operator to it. But as we have seen, if you're even in the thermodynamic limit, so now if you have a gap, you don't have to apply this very many times to get a very, very good overlap with the ground state. And therefore, somehow, of course, now we can say, okay, this is a matrix product state. The dimension of this matrix product, the bond dimension, would be, let's say, if this is 2, this would be 2 to the number of times that you apply it to. Let's say 2 to the, if you apply this L times, then the bond dimension would be 2 to the L. But somehow this L is kind of bounded. If you have a gap system, you know that this doesn't, like, this doesn't, there's kind of a limit. You don't have to go this, you don't have to do this very, very, very many times. That means that indeed somehow the ground state, that somehow this operator, this kind of object here, which is a matrix product state, has a very good overlap with the ground state. And therefore, let's not just say, okay, that means that, let's not try to find the ground state like this, let's not do this, represent the ground state like this, let's just do a variational calculation, let's just take any matrix product state with the largest bond dimension that we can deal with. And this will have a very good, this has a very good chance of having a good overlap with the exact ground state. Again, that's, at the end, this is certainly the simplest justification for using matrix product states as variational states for this. But it's actually a pretty convincing one. If you think about it, so it also immediately shows you how to generalize this whole formalism to higher dimensions. In higher dimensions, if you have, you can apply exactly the same trick. Okay? Instead of having a matrix product operator that looks like this, a Hamiltonian, you would have some kind of matrix product operator that also would have extra indices. So would have a plane, and there would be kind of indices sticking out and coming down. Okay? This would be your matrix product operator. And by exactly the same reason that you said, okay, I get already some kind of good overlap, but just starting with the product state, multiplying this thing a few times. And this is the state. And this turns out to be exactly the form of a PEPS. Okay, this is this generalization of a matrix product state to two dimensions. So you immediately see this from the point of view of these matrix product operators that indeed it makes sense. This is certainly something that should work. You also kind of feel already that indeed if the system is not capped, if you have a base, so of course if you have a finite dimensional system, a system that only on a finite number of spins, the system is always gapped. But somehow if you have a critical system, then this gap will typically scale like 1 over the system size. Then you will have to multiply many more times to get some kind of a good open up to the ground state. And that's indeed what you see. If you do the simulation of DMRG and you want to have a critical system, then somehow the bond dimension has to be much larger than if it's not critical. And somehow this is perfectly consistent with this kind of picture. Another advantage of looking at this picture like this, of the variational wave function, is that it immediately shows you actually, and it's amazing, but it took like a long time, it's only last year that we realized how to do this, it immediately shows you how to treat fermions. Okay, so if you want to do fermions in two dimensions within this formalism, at the end it's straightforward. You just define some kind of how does my Hamiltonian look like in this matrix product of operator formalism. And you say, okay, let's take this seriously, let's take this peps and we define your kind of fermion. So then these operators that you have there are kind of with they are creational annihilation operators that anti-commute with each other, and you just define this object like this and you get your peps and you get some kind of the right formulation of a variational formulation for, so you get actually you can immediately see how does this wave function, how does it have to look like to be physical, to make sense, to be indeed some kind of related to the ground state of Hamiltonian. Anyway, so in the last 10 minutes, I can now show, once we have this, how the DMRG works.
If I'm thinking about ladders, this intuition breaks down because the Hamiltonian volume. This sort of intuition breaks down because the Hamiltonian is no longer a nice operator like this.
It's still a nice operator. Even in two dimensions, you get kind of this locality. So this, the only thing is that somehow there will be some extra index here and some extra index here. You would still be a good answer. So it doesn't. It's for ladders or anything. It always.
So then why can't I just? I'm misunderstanding why if I just have a whole snake wall 2D that this intuition takes.
But I don't see any relationship actually between this snake. The Hamiltonian itself cannot be written. So if you want to write down your Hamiltonian in this kind of snake form, the bond dimension of your Hamiltonian would already have to be exponential. So
yeah, well, the constant bond dimension has to be some kind of planar version of that.
There's no way. So this intuition breaks down because the Hamiltonian would have to be larger. The bond dimension would have to be larger.
Right, yeah, basically. But frankly, you make this entirely, I know Matt has a formal argument, the gap Hamiltonian in 1D, you can show that matrix product state is a good approximation to the product state. This is a different way of potentially arguing. Can you make this completely rigorous? Or is there
no, it's not possible to make this rigorous. It goes somewhat that way. Because at the end, it's only an overlap, and you have to make some assumption about how many states are there, about the gap, the density of states above the gap. But this is just a hand waving argument. But I think
it's
I think it's intuitively that makes it clear that it needs somehow. This should be kind of an answer that makes sense. Actually, there's many other ways of justifying why matrix product states are good outcomes. Actually, let me give you another argument that is maybe even more might be more convincing. So again, it would be an argument that only applies for gap systems. So if you have a gap system, this is something that was kind of a folklore result for many years until Matthew Hastings proved it, is that if you have a gap system, the correlation functions are all decaying exponential. So you have a spin system. So now this is nothing, this is a spin system, and you know it's got, then in the ground state, all correlation functions have to decay exponentially if they in the ground state is unique. So that means that basically if you would trace out all these spins in the middle, so this is your wave function psi. Then you say, okay, let's look at my density matrix that I get when I trace out the spins that are in the middle of my chain. Okay, then I could basically get something that if this thing is large, much larger than the correlation length, and basically I should get something that is like rho left tensor rho right. There are no correlation whatsoever. There's no correlation whatsoever between this part and that part, because that block that you trace out is much larger than the correlation map. And that's intuitively you would think, okay, that means that somehow this made this reduced density matrix is then go left, tensor, go right. Now this in so that means that psi is a purification of that that density matrix. So there's kind of a very simple result in quantum information theory that tells you that if I have two states, I have a state psi and I have a state chi, and they are both purifications. So purification means nothing more than if I trace out a few of the qubits or a few of the spins, I get these kind of reduced density matrix. If these two people, or these two wave functions, have the same reduced density matrices, then this can only, then it follows that basically this psi is equal to some unitary acting on phi, where this unitary is only acting on the spins that you traced out. Okay, so you have two states, they have the same kind of reduced density matrix, then somehow if then they are related by unity transformation on the part of the spins that you traced out. But there's a trivial purification of that one, maybe something like a psi left, tensor psi right. Because if you have a tensor product, it means that of course there's also purification that is a tensor product, it doesn't have any correlations. Again, this psi left would kind of live here and a little bit here, and this psi right would kind of live there, and let's say on these qubits. But this theorem now tells you that actually these two states are equivalent up to unitary on this block. Okay, so that means that there exists a unitary. So I have a product state here. I just have this and this. I have a product state, everything to the left, everything to the right. And then there's a unitary that exists that just acts on this block that is a little bit larger than the correlation length that reproduces that kind of gets me to my original state back again. So that it means that, basically, it means that indeed somehow there's very few entanglement, or there's very few correlations, or there's some kind of, somehow there exists a unitary that I can apply on my original state. Of course, now you can U dagger on this state that disentangles the left from the right. What happens that if you make this argument, it's kind of an interesting exercise. If you make this argument, you're formulating in terms of matrix product state, this kind of gives you exactly matrix product states with the bond dimension that is related to the size of that block. Okay, so this gives you some more evidence that indeed somehow if you have a system with a finite correlation length, then matrix product states are kind of the right, should kind of capture the physics for describing that state. Now, another feature of matrix product states that makes them very interesting and intriguing is actually that they form a parametrization that somehow this is the only parametrization that I know that is very generic for let's say for spin 1/2 or for any other system that gives you translation invariant systems. Okay, so it's actually difficult to write down wave functions that are translation invariant that still have lots of correlations. Okay, now matrix product states actually have this. They can make them translation invariant by construction, and also they have the feature that they have very strong local correlations. Okay, because that actually happens that if you calculate correlation functions with matrix product states, all these correlation functions always decay exponentially. The correlations are very strong locally, and this is exactly what you want for a ground state of a local Hamiltonian. So what you want is, so there's always a competition, and that's why somehow quantum why quantum Hamiltonians are so interesting. There's always a competition. If you have something like the Heisenberg Hamiltonian, what you want is that basically all nearest neighbor spins are in a singlet state. Okay, because that's the ground state of your individual term in your Heisenberg Hamiltonian. But nevertheless, you also have kind of the competing thing that somehow your state must be translation invariant, because somehow the ground state of the Heisenberg Hamiltonian is translation invariant because it has the same symmetries as the Hamiltonian, and there's a competition between these two forces. And the matrix product states seem to kind of really give the right balance. Okay, they are translation invariant by construction, and they have very strong local correlations. Okay, there's all other kind of arguments that we can make. And you can also kind of make these arguments much more explicit, but I don't want to do this. The only thing that I want to sketch now is how to do the MRG, and we'll continue then tomorrow. So, although, yeah, maybe I don't have time. Let's just, you're probably all hungry, what time is it? Let's just stop.
5 minutes.
Yeah, let's just stop. Okay, thanks.
Just optimizing the parameters.
Yeah.